Lord Nowakis.
It's 3:15. There's no one in the place except you and me.
I'm Alan Lloyd Nowakis, and this is American Lit 1865 through present. And yes, as you can tell for the first time and maybe the last time, I'm actually indoors recording this video so that you can see there's an inside to my house. And this is actually, I'm filming with books behind me, which I always say never trust anyone with books behind them in a video. But I'm shooting this in my library here. We'll do a tour. As you can see, I'm a little obsessed with books, so I keep everything I read. See, look how smart I am. You can trust me on this. So what we're going to talk about today is The Man Who Was Almost a Man. I'm posting this video a little early, but that's okay, because I wanted to do a longer, much more complicated one on the Harlem Renaissance, where I'll hit on a lot of the stuff that I may skip in this. But let's go through the plot. We have 17-year-old Dave Saunders, who wants a gun. Okay, he's not at work. The other, again, 17 is that precarious age, right? You're not quite a boy. You're not quite a man, and you know he's being mocked by his coworkers, who are all, he's a field hand, right? And so he's being mocked by them, and so he dreams of the power that a gun will bring him, and goes home and, you know, asks, or first off, he stops, you know, Mr. Hawkins to get a catalog, and Mr. Hawkins gives him the catalog, but says, you know, I've got a gun for $2 I'll sell you. And he says, okay, hold on to it. I'll be back with the money, and goes home. Now, we know Mrs. Saunders here controls the money in the house. Mr. Saunders, again, is also a field hand, and again, there's, Rod is saying a lot here about race with this, but she is sort of conflicted between, you know, doing what is right, which would not be giving her son a gun and the money for a gun, and doing what, you know, the son wants. So she's conflicted, but she gives him the money. And what we see are a series of, which will tie into this title, a series of behavior that really proves he's not ready to be a man, right? The first one being he, you know, hides the gun under his pillow because he wants to go shoot it, and his mother demands that he immediately hand it over as soon as he buys it. And he claims to her that he's hidden it outside and that he'll get it to her in the morning. And so he gets up in the morning, passes Mr. Hawkins, and decides to fire the gun. But first he, you know, gets on this, using the mule Jenny to plow. And, you know, we see the death here of the mule. And this, it ties back in a little bit to barn burning, in this idea of the importance of these animals. You know, I didn't grow up on a farm. I don't know that much about animals. I did, but these are, you know, a mule is your livelihood when you're a farmer. And so, you know, even though we know he accidentally shoots Jenny, you know, he's really shooting something that's making Mr. Hawkins, who, you know, hurting him, which we know that Dave really wants to do, indirectly. And we see that later when he's leaving, when he sort of debates shooting into Mr. Hawkins's house if he'd only had one bullet left. So of course it shoots the Jenny. Of course, we have this myth about George Washington, where George Washington, you know, chopped down the cherry tree and said, I cannot tell a lie, I did it. Now, that didn't really happen. There's a lot of, that's mythology, and there's a lot of symbolism in that George Washington story. But we see, again, Dave not behave like a man. He claims that the Jenny fell onto the plow, and that was the hole. And of course, you know, he tries to cover it up with dirt, mud, and, you know, that's completely childish and not going to work, and not very mature of him. And of course, his mother knows what has happened before everyone else figures out it's a bullet hole. We see the father here is very violent and, you know, threatening to, you know, beat the bejesus out of his son. And then we're given this, you know, this gun was supposed to bring him responsibility. We see it costs him more responsibility, right? He's supposed to now work, you know, it's going to take a full year to pay off this debt to Mr. Hawkins for the mule. And tell me I'm not getting that name confused with the store owner. But anyway, I'm terrible with character names. So that night, he hops a train with a gun empty, no bullets, and leaves. And that's pretty much the story. Now, Jenny, let's go back to her. I said a little bit she represented, you know, the plantation owner and him trying to get back. She also represents, I think, is symbolic of Dave here, in that, you know, she's forced to work against her will for a lifetime. And that ties in to the racial aspect of this story, that, you know, even though African-Americans, you know, slavery's over, African-Americans are free, and at this point, have gained a lot of the rights of white people. You know, we're still under Jim Crow and other, you know, horrible things, segregation, but we see that, you know, our society has not really, rights, making a comment on that, has not really given them the opportunities. You know, this comes up a lot when people discuss slave reparations, and, you know, most white people are just like, that's the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard. And while it's, I think, logistically impossible, you do have to remember, you know, we have a race of people who were enslaved and then, you know, have never really gotten the full rights completely, certainly up to this point, that everyone else had. So, you know, we as a society really, you know, pushed them back, and Wright's making a comment on that. And the repercussions of that are still around today. So while I can say I've never done this, you know, it's really easy to say that. But, you know, we as a white society really are to blame here for this, and Wright's making that claim that you just, I mean, the dad's going to work as a field hand until he dies. Dave's going to work as a field hand until he dies, which brings us to that ending. And again, we see, you know, him jump the train and leave to dodge his responsibilities. Now, some people see this as a negative thing. Most people do, that he's just not mature enough to handle what he's done and pay for it. Other people see it as a positive thing. He's escaping this life of servitude. So it depends on really how you want to look at it. I think that really ties into the title, The Man Who Was Also a Man. I read a lot of times, and this would be an interesting essay topic, that this is a coming of age story. And yeah, that's a building's roman, right? We've used that term before. The question becomes, is it, right? Ask yourself that, and you could argue, again, great essay topic, because does he become a man in the end, or is he still just a child, right? I mean, avoiding his responsibilities. So, you know, you could make that argument that goes with the title. That would lead us to believe almost a man. You know, he certainly didn't make it to manhood status through these events and these behaviors. And so you could list those, you know, quote those in your paper and look to those things that would show that he's not actually a man, or that maybe, you know, argue the opposite, that he is, and look for proof from that. You know, the important thing with Richard Wright here, he became an expatriate from the Harlem Renaissance, moved to Paris, which, as Baldwin did, as a lot of American authors, both white and African-American, did. But he had a huge influence. He was the first really successful, really, really successful writer from the Harlem Renaissance. And I'm about to do a video on the Harlem Renaissance after this, but that's going to take a little preparation. The point is, you know, who knows? James Baldwin we have because of Richard Wright, we could argue. And James Baldwin, the next short story, The Man Who Are Going to Meet the Man, is probably my favorite thing we read in this book. And let me give you, I don't like to do trigger warnings. That's what they call when they're sort of dirty words or whatever in stories. But Going to Meet the Man is pretty upsetting. I mean, I've had students actually get up and leave, and I'll talk about this during that video, but students actually get up and leave the class, not because they were offended, but because they were so uncomfortable. So when you're reading that, you know, there's a lynching scene. Pay attention to that. Baldwin's writing there is really, really amazing during that point. And again, it goes back to, you know, Richard Wright sort of leading the way for him, Ellison, who wrote Invisible Man. So, you know, think those things through. I'm going to do a video on the Harlem Renaissance and then going to meet the man. And I'll see you in the next video.
It's 3:15. There's no one in the place except you and me. So set 'em up, Joe. I've got a little story you ought to know. just make it one for my baby and one more for the road. I've got the routine, so put another nickel in the machine. Cheer. I hope you did.